Tanter Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents ADHD, What Every Parent Needs to Know, 3rd edition, by Mark L. Wolraich, MD, FAAP, and Joseph F. Hagan, MD, FAAP. Narrated by Andre Bellido. Please note, many kinds of healthcare professionals provide primary care for children and manage their attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. These include pediatricians, pediatric nurse practitioners, and pediatric physician assistants, as well as family medicine physicians, family nurse practitioners, physician assistants, and others. To be inclusive and specific, we will refer to your child's health professional as a pediatric clinician. Likewise, both women and men are pediatric clinicians, so expect alternating pronouns for us as well. The information contained in the book is intended to complement, not substitute for, the advice of your child's pediatric clinician. Before starting any medical treatment or medical program, you should consult with your child's pediatric clinician, who can discuss your child's individual needs and counsel you about symptoms and treatment. If you have any questions about how the information in this book applies to your child, speak to your child's pediatric clinician. A note on gender. A good deal of discussion went into the use of pronouns he and she in this book, particularly when describing different subtypes of attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, ADHD, or different problems faced by children with ADHD. Although boys and girls can have any subtype of ADHD or any of the related problems, the ratio of boys to girls diagnosed with ADHD is about 3-to-1. And the combined type of ADHD, with all three key elements, impulsivity, hyperactivity, and inattention, is diagnosed about 2.5 times more frequently than the predominantly inattentive type. However, if all the children in a school system were evaluated, it is likely that the inattentive type would be found to be about 1.5 times more common than the combined type. The inattentive type is more likely to go undiagnosed, and girls are more likely to have that subtype than boys. With this as background, we have attempted to balance the use of he and she pronouns in this book in an interchangeable way. Introduction. You have probably picked up this copy of ADHD, What Every Parent Needs to Know, either because your child was recently diagnosed with attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, ADHD, or because you wish to learn more information about how you can best help your child with his ADHD. This book is the combined work of many healthcare and mental health professionals with expert levels of experience in caring for children like your child. All these colleagues are convinced that children, adolescents, and adults with ADHD, as well as the families that support them, will have the most success in school and in life if they understand what ADHD is, how it is properly treated, what to expect, and how families, teachers, and pediatric clinicians can work together for the lifelong management of ADHD. Almost all children have times when their attention or behavior veers out of control. For some children, these types of behaviors are more than just an occasional problem. Children with ADHD have behavior problems that are so frequent and significant that they interfere with their ability to function adequately on a daily basis. Attention deficit hyperactivity disorder is the most commonly diagnosed developmental behavioral condition in children. Approximately 6% to 9% of school-aged children are affected. It is a chronic condition whose symptoms continue in 60% to 80% of adolescents and even into adulthood. It can have effects on children's learning, ability to regulate behavior, social skills, and self-esteem. If you are just starting out and learning about a new diagnosis of ADHD, or if you have just experienced a bump in the road or a setback in your child's treatment, turn your attention to the not-so-distant future. Someday, before very long, your children will graduate high school and go off to college or enter the workforce. In ADHD, What Every Parent Needs to Know, you will learn about how to build your child's ADHD support and management team so that he can enjoy his success. You will learn what ADHD is and what it is not. You will be better prepared to make treatment decisions. You will be able to choose treatments that are proven to be effective and to ignore claims for treatments that do not work. You will learn to use your own strengths as parents to build your child's confidence to support his success. Your pediatric clinician will help you understand that your child can succeed and how you can help. Today's print and online media bombard parents with a mind-clogging glut of advice. Media reports claim that ADHD is both overdiagnosed and underdiagnosed. Many argue ADHD is overtreated, but careful studies show that it is often undertreated. Claims for medications can range from groundbreaking to dangerous. How can a responsible parent sort through this quagmire of contradictory information? In this book, you will learn when to suspect ADHD and how it must be carefully diagnosed. Careful and accurate diagnosis is the most important first step in helping your child. Once your child is diagnosed with ADHD, now what? How can you and your child's pediatric clinician, teachers, and others help your child address his problems and begin to experience success? It can happen. You will learn treatment options and be guided in how to choose wisely for your child. And since not every child's treatment is immediately successful, you will learn to be an advocate for your child, and you will be alerted to other problems that might complicate your child's ADHD. Discussions of evidence will be commonly found in this book. With so many contradicting opinions about the best treatment for ADHD, it is helpful to learn how to identify true evidence about treatments and to carefully analyze claims of effectiveness. You will want to become skilled at deciding what to consider and what to ignore. You will learn how to assess these claims about various treatments. There are alternative and complementary treatments for ADHD you may wish to consider, as there is evidence that they are effective in certain ways. There are also such treatments where the evidence shows that they do not work, or are even possibly harmful. What will the future bring for your child's teen years and beyond? Your success in helping your child with ADHD will grow from your understanding of this condition. You will find that some things come easy for your child, and other things are hard. You will learn to help your child manage his ADHD by finding his strengths and helping him apply these strengths to build his confidence. He will soon manage his studies and develop strong lifelong skills that will serve him in this effort, and he will do so with your help and guidance. Chapter 1. What is ADHD? Andrew Scott had always been an active child. From the time he learned to walk, his parents noticed he was into everything. Andrew's preschool teachers frequently commented on how active he was, and his kindergarten teacher observed that he was quite a handful. First grade passed without any major problems, though his level of activity seemed to overwhelm some of the other children during playtime. In third grade, however, Andrew began to fall behind in math and reading. His teacher said he was too restless. During class, he bothered the children around him. He seemed unable to focus on a learning activity for longer than a few minutes. On the playground, he was over-physical with his peers, invading their space and then overreacting when they pushed him away. Around the middle of the year, Andrew's teacher met with his parents. His teacher told them that Andrew's problems paying attention, his high activity level, and troubles with schoolwork may indicate the presence of attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, ADHD. She explained that ADHD often goes undetected until children enter school and academics, and social relationships begin to be affected. Despite the teacher's positive attitude, Andrew's parents were stunned by her recommendation that their son be evaluated for the causes of this behavior. They had always been challenged by their active child, but they had never considered his behavior out of the ordinary for a healthy young boy. As Andrew's father often pointed out, Andrew was just like me when I was in school. Eager, excited, and always on the go. While both parents agreed that Andrew could use some extra help with his social skills and reading, they did not see how these behaviors could be thought of as a medical condition. "I think his teacher just can't handle him in class," Andrew's mother told her husband later when they were back at home. She has a discipline problem, and she calls it ADHD. I think it's the school that should be evaluated. The Keller family was experiencing similar confusion. Their 12-year-old daughter, Emma, was also having problems. However, she was on the quiet and somewhat anxious side. Since early childhood, she had been a dreamer, whose thoughts tended to drift easily. She often forgot things she had recently learned, or been told, and spent much of her time alone. In recent years, her randomness and lack of organization had begun to seriously affect her school performance, social life, and family relationships. She was having trouble completing tasks, and was messy and careless about her schoolwork. Her parents noted that she was often forgetful or spacey. At times it seemed as if her mind was elsewhere, and that she was not listening. Still, Emma's parents felt that her behavior was typical of many girls her age, and was nothing that a little maturation and help with organization could not cure. Was it really necessary, they asked Emma's pediatrician, to consider this a medical issue or to start an evaluation? As different as Andrew's and Emma's situations seem to be, both are typical for children with ADHD. Attention deficit hyperactivity disorder limits children's ability to filter out unimportant input, focus, organize, prioritize, delay gratification, think before they act, or perform other activities called executive functions that most of us perform automatically. In children such as Andrew, with hyperactive impulse elements to his ADHD, the disorder presents itself as his not being able to control impulses or regulate activity levels, even when he knows how he is expected to behave. In those with inattentive type ADHD, including Emma, not being able to filter information means that someone walking by the classroom can claim as much attention as the teacher's lecture, and that a date with a friend can be forgotten in a flood of unsorted information. These behaviors, short attention span, forgetfulness, and not being able to sit still, unusually high activity level, and a tendency to act before thinking, are common in children. Families are often surprised when their child is referred for an evaluation. Adding to their confusion is the fact that these behaviors are present, but to a lesser degree in all children and adolescents, although those with ADHD exhibit more extreme and immature forms of these behaviors. Many school systems will not allow teachers to describe their concerns as perhaps ADHD, because they feel this is a diagnosis to be made by a physician or a psychologist. Instead, they will describe the behaviors that a child is showing that are interfering with his learning. These behaviors interfere in significant ways with children's day-to-day functioning, and they do not outgrow them at the same pace that other children do. Because other disorders, such as learning disabilities, oppositional defiant disorder, autism spectrum disorder, obsessive-compulsive disorder, anxiety, and depression can resemble ADHD, and in fact, often accompany it, it can be difficult to tell whether a child has another condition, ADHD, or both. Finally, the fact that ADHD is diagnosed through careful observations of inattentive, hyperactive, and impulsive behaviors across the major settings of a child's life, rather than with laboratory tests used to diagnose such disorders as type 1 diabetes, leads some adults and the popular press to question whether ADHD exists at all. Yet a large body of convincing evidence suggests that ADHD is a biological, brain-based condition. The scientific research on ADHD is more thorough and compelling than for most behavioral and mental health disorders, and even many medical conditions. Even so, among many parents, it remains controversial and misunderstood. As early as 1998, the National Institutes of Health, responding to public concern and debate about ADHD diagnosis and treatment, assembled a group of experts for a consensus conference on ADHD. These experts published their conclusions, stating that ADHD is indeed a medical disorder. Attention deficit hyperactivity disorder is among the most prevalent chronic childhood disorders, second only to asthma. National survey data from 2016 show 9.4% of U.S. children have been diagnosed with ADHD. The Centers for Disease Control and Prevention has reported that about 4.5 million children, ages 3 to 17 years, in the United States, have ADHD. And the condition currently accounts for as many as 30% to 50% of child referrals to mental health services. Many people believe that the prevalence of ADHD has increased significantly in recent decades, perhaps due to environmental factors, but there is no convincing evidence that this is the case. The number of children who have ADHD has likely remained roughly stable, but the number of children diagnosed with the condition has increased as more clinicians have become familiar with its symptoms and the problems it can cause. In addition, while it was originally thought to go away by puberty, it is now clear that many continue to have symptoms even into adulthood. A generally reliable method for diagnosing ADHD based on the child's behavior and functioning has been established. Parents whose children have been adequately evaluated for ADHD and who have implemented appropriate treatment as a result frequently report that the difference before and after their child's treatment is like night and day. While ADHD cannot be cured, children can be helped to compensate for their problems so that school performance and social relationships improve. As a result, their self-esteem increases, as do their chances for future successes. In this book, you will learn how ADHD is defined and recognized, how it is evaluated, and how, according to the latest reliable scientific research, it can best be treated. Researchers have identified the types of behavioral, academic, and social supports most likely to be useful at school and at home. Courses and specific therapies have been developed to pass this information on to parents and teachers in the community. You will also learn about special concerns in the evaluation and treatment of preschoolers and adolescents with ADHD, and the changing effect of this chronic condition over time. This is not to say that we now know everything there is to know about the nature and proper treatment of ADHD. A number of questions remain to be answered, and there is a great deal of research still to be done. Active, ongoing studies may provide further insight into how these children can improve their experience at each stage of life. The good news is that the evaluation and treatment of ADHD is at a much more advanced stage today than ever before. Armed with the knowledge provided to you in this book, you and your child will be able to address the challenges of ADHD with confidence and optimism. Before learning about how ADHD is recognized, diagnosed, and treated, however, it is necessary to understand exactly what ADHD is and what it is not. In this chapter, you will learn how the view of ADHD has evolved over time, how ADHD is defined today, what scientists believe may cause ADHD, how the condition typically alters a child's experience, and what are its long-term effects. Through it all, always keep in mind that you have a child with ADHD, rather than an ADHD child. He is a child first and foremost, and the problems associated with ADHD can be worked on. Never lose sight of the whole picture. Myths and misconceptions about ADHD. Much misinformation is circulated about attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, ADHD, and its causes, diagnosis, and treatment over a number of decades. Following are untrue assumptions about the disorder, along with explanations aimed at clarifying the issues. 1. My preschooler is too young to have ADHD. Many parents believe that ADHD is a problem of school-aged children, but in fact, the symptoms of ADHD and the diagnosis of the condition can occur as early as the preschool years. At times, even doctors have difficulty differentiating typical behavior from behaviors that suggest a preschooler has ADHD. Although a young child may typically have characteristics like impulsivity or hyperactivity, these can be symptoms of ADHD as well. A pediatrician will evaluate the intensity of these behaviors in a preschooler to help in making the diagnosis. Attention deficit hyperactivity disorder is diagnosed when these problems get to the point where they are significantly and consistently interfering with the preschooler's life, development, self-esteem, and general functioning. 2. He's just lazy and unmotivated. This assumption is a common response to the behavior exhibited by a child who is struggling with ADHD. A child who finds it nearly impossible to stay focused in class, or to complete a lengthy task such as writing a long essay, may try to save face by acting as though he does not want to do it, or is too lazy to finish. This behavior may look like laziness or lack of motivation, but it stems from real difficulty in functioning. All children want to succeed and get praised for their good work. If such tasks were easy for children with ADHD to accomplish and provided rewarding feedback, those children would seem just as motivated as anyone else. 3. He's a handful, or she's a daydreamer, but that's normal. They just don't let kids be kids these days. It is true that all children are impulsive, active, and inattentive at times, sometimes to the extreme. A child with ADHD, however, is more than just a handful for his parents and teachers, or a daydreamer who tends to lose herself in thought. The child's hyperactivity and/or inattentiveness constitutes a real day-to-day functional disability. That is, it seriously and consistently impedes the ability to succeed at school, fit into family routines, follow household rules, maintain friendships, interact positively with family members, avoid injury, or otherwise manage in his or her environment. As you will learn in Chapter 2, this clear functional disability is what pediatricians look for when diagnosing ADHD and recommending treatment. 4. Treatment for ADHD will cure it. The goal is to get off medication as soon as possible. Attention deficit hyperactivity disorder is a chronic condition that often does not entirely go away, but instead changes form over time. Many older adolescents and adults are able to organize their lives and use techniques that allow them to adequately compensate for their weaknesses, so they are able to forego medical treatment, but many continue various forms of treatment and receive support throughout their lifespans. Depending on the circumstances and demands as a person matures, this may or may not include continuing with medication or other treatments for ADHD at different times, even through adult life. The true goal is to function well at each stage of childhood and adolescence and as an adult, rather than to stop any or all treatments as soon as possible. 5. He focuses on his video games for hours. He can't have ADHD. For the most part, ADHD poses problems with tasks that require focused attention over long periods. Not so much for activities that are highly engaging or stimulating like media and video games. School can be especially challenging for a person with ADHD because the typical classroom lecture can be relatively unstimulating in terms of visuals, sound, and physical activity. Assignments can be long and require sustained, organized thought and effort. And the daily routine can be less structured and predictable than a child with ADHD might require. Most children with ADHD are diagnosed during their school years precisely because the academic, social, and behavioral demands during these years are so difficult for them. The difficulties that such children experience may make it seem that school is the problem, and certainly that possibility should be considered, but it is more likely to be a result of the child's struggle to manage in this environment. Other situations that can be problematic for children with ADHD include social interactions with their constant, subtle exchange of emotion and social information, sports that require a high degree of focus or concentration, and extracurricular activities that require them to sit still, listen, or wait their turn for long periods. 6. ADHD is caused by poor parental discipline. Attention deficit hyperactivity disorder is not a result of poor discipline. Although behaviors that stem from ADHD can challenge otherwise effective parenting styles, inconsistent limit setting and other ineffective parenting practices can, however, worsen its expression. In chapters 5 and 6, you will find a number of proven parenting techniques that can help children with ADHD manage their behavior. 7. The problem is with the school program. They are not strict enough with my child. Just like ADHD is not a result of poor discipline, it is also not caused by bad teachers or a lack of school rules. The best teachers can see when a child is struggling and will partner with parents to seek solutions for success in school. 8. If, after a careful evaluation, a child doesn't receive the ADHD diagnosis, she doesn't need help. Attention deficit hyperactivity disorder is diagnosed on a continuum, which means that a child can exhibit a number of ADHD-type behaviors, yet not to the extent that she is diagnosed with ADHD. This does not mean she doesn't need help coping with her problems. The family of a child who does not meet the criteria for ADHD but has similar problems may be offered pediatric counseling, education about the range of typical developmental behaviors, home behavior management tools, school behavior management recommendations, social skills interventions, and help with managing homework involving organization and planning. 9. Children with ADHD outgrow this condition. Parents and many doctors once believed that as children with ADHD enter adolescence and then move into adulthood, their ADHD will no longer be an issue. But recent studies have shown that some aspects of ADHD can persist well into adult life for many of these children. Some adults can still benefit from the use of ADHD medication for the rest of their lives. Others have developed enough coping skills and improvement that medication can be discontinued. Sometimes in older teens and adults, medications may be used intermittently for situations and tasks that need fuller concentration. Medication use may often vary depending on what occupation they choose, and their ability to succeed in relationships and other social activities. No matter what the circumstances of particular adults may be, however, they can make adjustments in their environment, take full advantage of their own strengths, and lead very productive adult lives, even when aspects of ADHD still persist. How is ADHD defined? On television and online, in magazines and newspapers, in social media, and in thousands of everyday conversations, there is ongoing debate around whether certain ADHD-type behaviors are a typical childhood experience, or constitute a disorder that requires treatment. The issue of exactly where and how to draw the line between typical behavior and a clinical condition may become even clearer as increasingly sophisticated diagnostic techniques provide researchers with more information about the nature of the precise brain processes involved in children with ADHD. But the use of these tools and techniques for these purposes still lies in the future. For more than a century, physicians have been aware of children displaying the behaviors that we now call ADHD. In 1902, British pediatrician George Still first formally documented a condition in which children seemed inattentive, impulsive, and hyperactive, stating his belief that this was a result of biological makeup rather than poor parenting or other environmental factors. Research in the 1980s supported this hypothesis and led to the use of the term attention deficit disorder. In 1987, in response to even more precise information provided by new studies, the term attention deficit hyperactivity disorder was introduced. Today, ADHD is defined by the American Psychiatric Association as developmentally inappropriate attention and/or hyperactivity and impulsivity so pervasive and persistent as to significantly interfere with a child's daily life. Children with ADHD have difficulty controlling their behavior in most major settings, including home and school. They may speed about in constant motion, make noise nonstop, refuse to wait their turn, and crash into everything around them. At other times, they may drift as if in a daydream, failing to pay attention to or finish what they start. They may have trouble learning and remembering. They may appear disorganized. An impulsive nature may put them in actual physical danger. Because they have difficulty controlling this behavior, they may be labeled a bad kid or a space cadet. These problems begin to occur relatively early in life, before age 12 years, though they sometimes are not recognized until a child is older. However, if there are absolutely no indications of ADHD before age 12 years, an alternative explanation for a child's behaviors should be sought. Professionals have identified clear differences between the functioning of a child without ADHD and a child with the condition. The presence of ADHD may be suspected if the 1. Inattentive, impulsive, or hyperactive behavior is not age-appropriate. That is, if it is not typical of children of the same age who do not have ADHD. 2. Behavior leads to chronic problems in daily functioning, a mild tendency to daydream, or an active temperament, which may cause occasional problems for a child, but is not seriously disabling, is not considered evidence of ADHD. 3. Behavior is the child's usual way of acting and not a result of poor care, physical injury, abuse, or neglect, disease, or other environmental influences. One way to determine whether the problem is environmental is to look at whether the problem occurs in more than one setting, such as at home and at school. If not, then an environmental cause, such as stresses at home or an inappropriate classroom placement, is more likely than ADHD to be the cause of the problem for the child. For a child's condition to be diagnosed as ADHD, all three of these conditions must be met. Attention deficit hyperactivity disorder can only be recognized by its symptoms and by the problems that these symptoms create for the child. This is why it is so important for parents, teachers, mental health professionals, and medical experts to work together when evaluating a child for ADHD. Each contributes his or her own observations, experience, and expertise to create a comprehensive picture of the child's social, academic, and emotional progress. Attention deficit hyperactivity disorder is divided into three general subtypes: predominantly hyperactive impulsive presentation, predominantly inattentive presentation, and combined presentation. Children with predominantly hyperactive impulsive type ADHD may fidget or squirm in their seat, have difficulty waiting their turn, and show a tendency to be disorganized. They may act immaturely, have a poor sense of physical boundaries, and tend toward destructive behaviors and conduct problems. Children with predominantly inattentive type ADHD, on the other hand, may seem distracted and spacey, or daydreamy, but not show the hyperactive component of the disorder. They may seem to process information slowly, and may also have a learning disorder, anxiety, or depression. Children with combined type ADHD typically exhibit many of the behaviors of the first two subtypes. Girls and ADHD. The fact that many more boys than girls are diagnosed with attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, ADHD, at a ratio of approximately 2-to-1 or 3-to-1, has led to the mistaken belief among many parents and teachers that ADHD is a boys' disorder that rarely occurs in girls. More girls remain undiagnosed because they have the inattentive type of ADHD and tend to be overlooked entirely or do not attract attention until they are older. This means that girls are less likely to be referred for evaluation and to receive the help they need. Even when diagnosis and treatment have been obtained, girls with ADHD are further disadvantaged by the fact that most ADHD research to date has focused on boys. Little is known about potential differences between the genders in the development of the condition over time or response to medication and other forms of treatment. Compared with other girls, girls with ADHD experience more depression, anxiety, distress, poor teacher relationships, stress, external locus of control, the feeling that the winds of fate control their destiny instead of themselves, and problems in school. Compared with boys with ADHD, girls with ADHD experience more difficulties from feeling anxious, distressed, depressed, or spacey. They have less of a feeling that they can take control in solving problems that they face. If your daughter has been referred for evaluation for ADHD, or if you suspect that she may have the condition, it is important not to discount the possibility just because she is female. Teachers may not recognize more subtle signs of inattention. They may under-refer girls for evaluation, even when their symptoms are the same as boys. As a result, girls are less likely than boys to receive sufficient medical treatment once they have been diagnosed. Be aware that some socio-cultural beliefs about girls, that they tend to daydream, that they just are not interested in academics, may mask a real problem in your child's ability to function. If your daughter is diagnosed with ADHD, ask the pediatrician to keep you updated on ongoing research about the development of ADHD in girls, the particular challenges girls with ADHD are likely to meet, and the different ways in which they may respond to various forms of treatment. These subtypes tend to be diagnosed at different ages and stages of development. Because of the hyperactivity and impulsivity, children with predominantly hyperactive impulsive type or combined type may be diagnosed as early as the preschool years in extreme situations. Children with predominantly inattentive type often go undetected until fourth grade or even later, when increased demands for sustained attention and more homework lead to significant problems in functioning. In the early grades, children learn to read, but at around fourth grade, they need to begin to read to learn. When this transition takes place, children with inattentive type typically begin to have more problems. While the problems of hyperactivity slash impulsivity and inattentiveness may seem at first to be unrelated, they both influence a child's inability to focus and function well in school, with peers, and in the family. Attention deficit hyperactivity disorder can be thought of as a range of attentional disorders, with a number of possible symptoms shown at different ages and developmental stages. What causes ADHD? No single cause has yet been identified for ADHD. Many risk factors have been noted, however, that affect a child's brain development and behavior, which, acting in combination, may lead to ADHD symptoms. They include genetic factors, variations in temperament, a child's individual differences in emotional reactivity, activity level, attention, and self-regulation, medical causes, especially those that affect brain development, and a host of environmental influences on the developing brain, including toxins such as lead, prenatal alcohol use, and nutritional deficiencies. Some research finds that children with ADHD may experience a delay in the typical maturing of their brain. Despite the many advances in research on the causes of ADHD, none of these findings are yet ready to help physicians make the diagnosis of ADHD. Researchers are certain that ADHD tends to run in families. Close relatives of people with ADHD have about 5 times greater chance of having ADHD themselves, as well as a higher risk for such common accompanying disorders as anxiety, depression, learning disabilities, and conduct disorders. An identical twin is at high risk of sharing his twin's ADHD, and a sibling of a child with ADHD has about a 30% chance of having similar problems. Although no single gene has been identified for ADHD, research continues in this area. Brain imaging studies have found some differences in brain anatomy between children diagnosed with ADHD and those who have not been diagnosed, but no consistent pattern has yet emerged from these studies that would be helpful in confirming a diagnosis. The fact that children and adolescents respond so consistently to stimulant medications, and that these medications influence biochemical systems in the brain, suggests that biochemical causes may contribute to ADHD symptoms as well. This remains an area of active research. In the coming years, newer brain imaging tools and more sophisticated genetic techniques are likely to continue to shed more light on the processes underlying ADHD. Still, it is unlikely that a single cause will be identified. ADHD over time. Attention deficit hyperactivity disorder is a complex disorder with different challenges arising at each new phase of a child's development. Children who are at risk for developing ADHD generally carry some symptoms with them as early as preschool age and continuing throughout adolescence and even into adulthood. Attention deficit hyperactivity disorder is sometimes diagnosed in preschoolers who display extremely high activity levels and impulsiveness. As children grow into adolescence, their ADHD-associated behaviors may persist and become just as problematic as they were earlier in life. They may have difficulty concentrating and be disorganized and easily distracted. Problems in adolescence with ADHD symptoms are likely to be expressed in different ways than they were in early childhood. Hyperactivity, for example, frequently takes center stage in early childhood, but diminishes and may no longer be a problem by late adolescence or early adulthood. Inattention and impulsivity are likely to persist and can affect an adult's educational experience, work life, and relationships. Driving can also be a challenge with an increased chance for accidents or traffic tickets. Learning disabilities that were present during childhood also continue to exist in later years, as can any emotional, behavioral, and social problems that have not been fully resolved. For more information about ADHD in adolescence, see Chapter 11. At one time or another, all children and adolescents with ADHD may face some challenges relating to family relationships, status among their peers, social skills, academic achievement, self-esteem, self-perception, or accidental injury. With help, however, children can learn to manage their symptoms in their early years, as well as through adolescence and into adulthood. Early and accurate diagnosis is the first step toward organizing a plan that can make a difference to your child and your family. As you begin to focus on the problems and issues that your child is facing, do not forget to appreciate and encourage his unique strengths and abilities as well, and to communicate that to your child. A child with ADHD, like all other children, not only thrives on positive reinforcement and praise, but also desperately needs to know that his symptoms do not make him bad, undisciplined, stupid, unmotivated, or lazy, as is so often implied. Educating affected children about what ADHD is and what it is not will help them cope with whatever discouraging comments or self-doubts come their way. The more they understand, the greater are their chances of success. Finally, children with ADHD frequently grow up to become successful and happy adults. In the chapters that follow, you will learn how to identify, treat, effectively parent, and advocate for your child in ways that will help him minimize his challenges and fulfill his enormous promise. A parent's story. Missed clues and lost opportunities. I suspected from my son's preschool days that he might have ADHD. Not because of his activity level, but because he could never stay focused on a single activity, and he tended to forget things he had just learned. To me, it was obvious that he was having real problems, but his teachers did not believe me, because he is also unusually bright. They assumed that his restless behavior and underachievement were a result of just being bored. It was only in middle school when my son began forgetting homework assignments, not taking notes, and even forgetting to take home books that he needed for homework from one day to the next, that his teachers began to think something serious might be going on. I remember one day when I was at the school for a parent-teacher conference, I saw him standing in the hall looking confused. I asked him what was wrong, and he told me he'd forgotten how to get to his next class. He did not know what to do or where to go. That was the day I decided to have him evaluated by his pediatrician. He was diagnosed with ADHD and is being treated now. His situation has improved, but I wish we had done this earlier before he fell so far behind. It is a huge relief to him, at least, to know that the problems he had been having at school were not his fault, but were symptoms of his condition. My biggest hope for him is that he realizes the potential he had when he was born. Roberta, Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Chapter 2. Does my child have ADHD? Evaluation and diagnosis. If only it were as clear-cut to diagnose attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, ADHD, as it is to diagnose a broken bone. Unfortunately, this is not the case. A broken bone is suspected after an injury and because of pain. A simple x-ray confirms the diagnosis. Furthermore, a broken bone just doesn't work like it did before it was fractured. As you will learn in this chapter, neither of these advantages exists in determining whether a child has ADHD. No laboratory tests, no urine or blood tests, and no behavioral tests by themselves can prove objectively whether ADHD is present. To complicate things further, the symptoms that characterize ADHD, inattention, hyperactivity, and impulsivity, occur in most children from time to time. Deciding whether a child's behaviors signal the presence of ADHD is, therefore, a complex process that involves comparing a child's behaviors and abilities to function with those of other children his age. To do this, pediatricians and mental health professionals must rely on information from parents, other caregivers, and a child's teachers, or other school professionals through observations, interviews, and questionnaires, specifically designed to evaluate behaviors seen in children and adolescents with ADHD. Interviews including both parents and the child being evaluated are also used to determine if there are other alternative causes for the behavior, or to find if there are additional problems, such as anxiety. In addition, the interviews help to evaluate whether specific problems may be interfering with the child's life on a daily basis. A diagnosis based on these types of evaluation procedures can become even more challenging when, as is often the case, other problems exist, such as vision or hearing problems, emotional disorders, or learning disabilities. An evaluation may require a team of professionals with different specialties because some of the accompanying problems are more medical in nature, some are more psychological, and others are related to learning and language processes. Several professional organizations, including the American Academy of Pediatrics, AAP, have developed guidelines in recent years that standardize the evaluation process for ADHD. As a result, diagnosis of the condition has become more consistent and accurate. In this chapter, you will learn how a child is evaluated for ADHD, from the first recognition that something may be wrong, through a methodical assessment of the specific problems that need addressing. Along the way, you will find information about the types of behaviors that often alert adults to the possible presence of ADHD in children, how your child's pediatric clinician will evaluate him and arrive at a diagnosis, how your child's particular subtype of ADHD will be identified, how clinicians will pinpoint the presence of any accompanying conditions, how a team approach that involves you, your child, his educators, and his clinicians all working together can bring about the best diagnosis and prepare you for planning a course of treatment. Early warning signs when ADHD is first suspected. Most experts agree that the tendency to develop ADHD is present from birth. Yet ADHD behaviors are often not noticed until children enter elementary school. One reason for this delay is the fact that nearly all preschool-aged children frequently exhibit some of the core behaviors or symptoms of ADHD: inattention, impulsivity, and hyperactivity, as part of their typical development. But as other children gradually begin to grow out of such behaviors, children with ADHD do not, and those behaviors interfere with how well the child can function. This difference becomes increasingly clear as the years pass. School settings can highlight a child's problems relating to inattention, impulsivity, and hyperactivity because classroom activities demand an increased amount of focus, patience, and self-control. These types of demands are not as prevalent at home or in playgroups, so in those settings, the child may have had fewer problems. Usually by the time a child with ADHD reaches 7 years of age, his parents have already become aware that their child's inattentiveness, level of activity, or impulsiveness is greater than is typical. Sometimes these suspicions develop later, particularly in bright children when the problems are mostly with paying attention and not hyperactivity, but it is unusual for ADHD symptoms to not have occurred before 12 years of age. So if symptoms are not observed until the teen years or later, and can't be remembered before age 12, it is likely something other than ADHD is causing the issues. You may have noticed that your child finds it nearly impossible to focus on a workbook for even a short period, even when you are there to assist him. Or you may still feel as worn out at the end of a day with your overly active 8-year-old as you did when he was 2. Your child may ask adults questions so often that you have begun to suspect it is not normal. Or you may have noticed that he does not pick up on obvious social rules that his playmates are already beginning to adopt, like respecting others' personal space or letting other people have a turn to talk. It can be difficult for a parent to tell whether such behaviors are just part of the typical process of growing up. Plenty of 6-year-olds get bored with workbooks. Or whether you are not strict enough. Maybe I've been too inconsistent with setting limits. Are the behavior problems severe enough to indicate a concerning problem? Will they improve as your child matures? For a child to be diagnosed with the disorder, the AAP advises pediatric clinicians to gather information about the child's behavior in at least one other major setting besides his home, including a review of any reports provided by teachers and school professionals. By comparing the child's behavior in two or more settings, the pediatric clinician can begin to differentiate among such varied reasons for attentional problems as a difficult but typical temperament, ineffective parenting practices, inappropriate academic setting, and other challenges. The pediatric clinician can also clarify whether the child's behavior is interfering with his ability to function adequately in more than one setting, another requirement for diagnosis. Something's not right. What parents notice when ADHD behaviors emerge. It is sometimes hard to match the behavior we observe in our children with the formal terms used by pediatricians and other medical professionals. We rarely think of our children as having hyperactive impulsive problems. Instead, we think, why can't he ever settle down? To confuse matters, the terms that doctors and other clinicians use for these behaviors have changed over the years. The term ADD, attention deficit disorder, was once commonly used and referred primarily to the form of attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, ADHD, with inattentive-only symptoms. These children are not overly active, and their symptoms may even go unnoticed by many adults for a while, because their behavior is not disruptive. To the most common children with ADHD, the qualifying description of with hyperactivity had to be added to ADD. Now all children with this condition are considered to have ADHD, but within that diagnosis, there are three subtypes: inattentive, hyperactive impulsive, and combined subtypes. When reviewing the list that follows of typical remarks made about children with ADHD, ask yourself how many times per day or week you say or think the same things yourself. It is true that all parents make such comments now and then, but parents of children with ADHD continue to see the same behaviors on a daily basis and for extended periods, long after other children have progressed. Parents of children with predominantly inattentive type ADHD say, "He seems like he's always daydreaming. He never answers when I talk to him. I wonder if he hears me. He loses everything. I've had to buy 4 new lunchboxes since school started. I'll ask him to go up to his room and get dressed, and 10 minutes later, I find him playing with his toys with only his shirt on. He can't remember what he learns because he misses instructions and explanations in school. Even though we work so hard on his schoolwork at night, by the next day, he's forgotten everything. Some teachers have called him their space cadet, an underachiever, an airhead, or their random student." Parents of children with predominantly hyperactive impulsive type ADHD say, "He never slows down. You can never get him to sit down to finish a meal or get ready for bed. He interrupts constantly. You can't have a decent conversation when he's in the room. He never thinks before he acts. He knows he shouldn't run across the street before stopping to look, but he does it all the time. I worry about him being safe. He just isn't. He operates out of order, like ready, fire, aim. His classmates don't like him. He's always getting in their face. No one invites him over to their house. He always has to be first, and things always have to be his way." First steps toward evaluation. If you've begun to think that your child's poor progress at school, limited friendships, or frequent discipline problems add up to more than typical childhood behaviors, schedule an appointment with his teacher or school counselor as soon as possible. These people see your child daily in a group setting where they can compare his behavior and ability to function to that of many other children of the same age. Teachers and counselors are trained to recognize symptoms of ADHD and similar disorders. But even with special training, it can be easy to miss milder symptoms or a subtler problem. Certainly, they will be interested in your observations and concerns, and will be able to give you a clearer idea of your child's experience at school, where ADHD so often manifests itself and creates problems. Often it is the teacher or counselor who first notices that a child is failing to progress in ways that may indicate that he has ADHD or a related disorder. In these instances, it is important for the teacher to contact the child's parents without delay to discuss the issue. Although teachers may identify more than 15% of their students as showing many of the behaviors compatible with ADHD and recommend those students for an evaluation by their pediatric clinician, not all these students here will actually be diagnosed with ADHD after a careful evaluation. Regardless of whether your child will end up being diagnosed with ADHD, it is important to follow up on teachers' concerns. The sooner a child with ADHD symptoms can be evaluated, diagnosed, and effectively treated, the greater his chances of succeeding in school with good self-esteem. If you and your child's teacher or other caregiver agree that your child is clearly having problems functioning in the areas of difficult-to-manage behaviors, or learning at home or at school, make an appointment with his pediatric clinician to consider beginning an evaluation. Pediatricians are used to evaluating children for developmental or behavioral problems, and because ADHD is such a common problem, they often screen for it in school-aged children during routine health visits. Questions your child's healthcare professional may ask you about school. Do you have any concerns about your child's development or learning? How is your child enjoying school? What concerns do you have about his social or academic experience? Please share any concerns you may have about your child's mood or behavior, such as attention, hitting, temper, worries, not participating in play with others, irritability, mood, or activity level. Confirming the diagnosis and identifying your child's specific problem areas. Not all active children, or children who don't pay attention well, have ADHD. Many ADHD symptoms are typical behaviors in preschool-aged children. Differences in development and variations in behaviors must be carefully considered in the diagnostic evaluation. Pediatricians and other experts rely on knowledge about how ADHD-type behaviors are expressed at different ages, as described here. Common symptoms of inattention. Early childhood, preschool and early school years. 1. Behavior within typical range. Difficulty paying attention more than briefly to a storybook or quiet task, such as coloring or drawing. 2. Behavior signaling an inattention problem. Sometimes unable to complete games or activities without being distracted, is unable to complete a game with a child of comparable age, and only attends to any activity for a very short period before shifting attention to another object or activity. Symptoms are present to the degree that they cause some family difficulties. 3. Behavior signaling the possible presence of attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, ADHD, predominantly inattentive type. The child is unable to function and play appropriately and may seem immature, does not engage in any activity long enough, is easily distracted, is unable to complete activities, has a much shorter attention span than the other children the same age, often misses important aspects of an object or situation, rules of games or sequences, and does not persist in various self-care tasks, dressing or washing, to the same extent as other children of comparable age. The child shows problems in many settings over a long period and is affected functionally. Middle childhood, later primary grades through preteen years, and adolescence. 1. Behavior within typical range. May not persist very long with the task the child does not want to do, such as reading an assigned book or homework, or a task that requires concentration, such as cleaning something. Adolescents may be easily distracted from tasks that they do not want to perform. 2. Behavior signaling an inattention problem. At times, the child misses some instructions and explanations in school, begins a number of activities without completing them, has some difficulties completing games with other children or grown-ups, becomes distracted, and tends to give up easily. The child may not complete or succeed at new activities, has some social deficiency, and does not pick up subtle social cues from others. 3. Behavior signaling the possible presence of ADHD, predominantly inattentive type. The child has significant school and social problems, often shifts activities, does not complete tasks, is messy, and is careless about schoolwork. The child may start tasks prematurely and without appropriate review, as if he were not listening, has difficulty organizing tasks, dislikes activities that require close concentration, is easily distracted, and is often forgetful. Common symptoms of hyperactivity/impulsivity. Early childhood, preschool and early school years. 1. Behavior within typical range. The child runs in circles, does not stop to rest, may bang into objects or people, and asks questions constantly. 2. Behavior signaling a hyperactivity/impulsivity problem. The child frequently runs into people or knocks things down during play, gets injured frequently, and does not want to sit for stories or games. 3. Behavior signaling the possible presence of attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, ADHD, hyperactive impulsive type. The child runs through the house, jumps and climbs excessively on furniture, will not sit still to eat or be read to, and is often getting into things that could be harmful or he was told not to touch. Middle childhood, later primary grades through preteen years. 1. Behavior within typical range. The child plays active games for long periods. The child may occasionally do things impulsively, particularly when excited. 2. Behavior signaling a hyperactivity/impulsivity problem. The child may butt into other children's games, interrupt frequently, and have problems completing chores. 3. Behavior signaling the possible presence of ADHD, hyperactive impulsive type. The child is often talking and interrupting, cannot sit still at mealtimes, is often fidgeting when watching television, makes noise that is disruptive, and grabs toys or other objects from others. Adolescence. 1. Behavior within typical range. The adolescent engages in active social activities, social media, dancing, for long periods and may engage in risky behaviors with peers. 2. Behavior signaling a hyperactivity/impulsivity problem. The adolescent engages in fooling around that begins to annoy others, and he fidgets in class or while watching television. 3. Behavior signaling the possible presence of ADHD, hyperactive impulsive type. The adolescent is restless and fidgety while doing any and all quiet activities, interrupts and bugs other people, and gets into trouble frequently. Hyperactive symptoms decrease or are replaced with a sense of restlessness. To create a uniform process for diagnosing ADHD among school-aged children, the AAP has created a list of standard guidelines for pediatricians to follow in evaluating a child reported to be inattentive, hyperactive, impulsive, or struggling academically, or having behavioral problems. These guidelines are based on the latest evidence about ADHD and other problems that might be seen along with ADHD, and the diagnostic procedures most commonly used. You should expect your child's pediatric clinician to follow these recommended steps, or a procedure much like them. The evaluation process will most likely require at least one long visit or two or three regular visits to the doctor, possibly longer sessions than you may be used to, and the filling out of a number of questionnaires, checklists, and other information to help evaluate your child. Your child's pediatric clinician may also ask you to forward questionnaires to his teacher, or ask the teacher to write a brief statement about your child's behavior and learning in the classroom before your first visit to make the initial interview more productive. The American Academy of Pediatrics recommends Diagnostic Guidelines for ADHD. To ensure that children referred for evaluation for Attention Deficit Hyperactivity Disorder, ADHD, receive the most reliable, thorough, and accurate assessment possible, the American Academy of Pediatrics has developed a set of diagnostic and evaluation guidelines and recommends that pediatricians follow the steps outlined as follows. Your child's pediatrician may prefer one variation or another of a particular step. Talking in person or on the phone with the teacher, asking the teacher to write a brief narrative instead of or in addition to requesting written questionnaires, but, in general, each of these steps should be considered. 1. Pediatricians should initiate an evaluation of ADHD for any child 4 to 18 years of age who has significant academic or behavioral problems and symptoms of inattention, hyperactivity, or impulsivity. Attention deficit hyperactivity disorder often becomes apparent when a child enters a structured school setting, but symptoms can emerge prior to kindergarten or may not be recognized until adolescence. 2. To make a diagnosis of ADHD, pediatricians should determine the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, 5th edition, DSM-5, criteria have been met, including documentation of several symptoms in more than one major setting, with information obtained primarily from reports of parents or guardians and teachers. The DSM-5 is a manual published by the American Psychiatric Association that describes all mental health conditions in children and adults. Information obtained from parents, guardians, and caregivers should be the basis for determining if the DSM-5 criteria are met. This most recent revision of DSM was released in 2013. 3. In the evaluation of a child for ADHD, pediatricians should include assessment for other conditions that might occur along with ADHD, including emotional or behavioral, anxiety, depressive, oppositional defiant, and conduct disorders, developmental, learning and language disorders, and physical, tics, sleep apnea, conditions. Your child's pediatric clinician will start by listening to your observations and experience with your child's behavior and the difficulties that you have observed him having, along with your explanations of why you think, or do not think, that they may be related to ADHD. In addition to examining written reports from teachers, school counselors, or caregivers, your pediatrician may ask you to relate what you have been told about your child's behavior in school and in his other daily settings outside the home. In many cases, parents and teachers' opinions about a child differ significantly. This is common and not unexpected. Your child's pediatrician will be prepared for this possibility and will listen carefully to reports from each reporter. She may ask to speak with other adults in your child's life, your spouse or partner, former teachers, coaches, others in your community, to gain a broader impression of the types of problems your child may be experiencing. Do not be surprised if your child's pediatric clinician seems to rely much more on these reports than on her own observation of your child. Children with ADHD do not necessarily exhibit their typical behavior while in the doctor's office, so she will not expect to see them. Keep in mind that ADHD, an attentional disorder, usually manifests itself in routine or monotonous situations, and visits to the doctor's office tend to be stimulating and outside of a child's usual routines. Likewise, though she will perform a physical examination, she will not rely on this to indicate whether ADHD is present, because there are no physical findings that, by themselves, verify ADHD. Instead, she will look for signs of medical conditions that can be associated with symptoms of ADHD. Your pediatrician will carefully review your child's and your family's medical history for ADHD-related disorders and other medical conditions that can have ADHD-like symptoms. Because ADHD has been shown to run in families, the discovery that you or other relatives have experienced ADHD-specific or similar symptoms may help point the way toward an accurate diagnosis.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.